Central Texas Gardener. I'm Tom Spencer. You know, the best thing about grueling summers is a chance to enjoy outstanding colors with plants that thrive in the heat. Today, Christine and Bill Reed from Reed's Nursery have new ideas that take the sweat out of summertime gardening. On tour, visit a perennial cottage garden that's designed for all seasons.
Although Sue Ford's garden in Fredericksburg isn't old, the arbor she bought from a neighbor signifies the mood that she and designer Patrick Kerwin wanted to create. They wanted an antique sort of attitude to go with the old house, including native plants, tough water-wise perennials and shrubs, and naturalizing spring bulbs. Sue and Patrick didn't arrive at their decisions in one day. They only knew that Sue didn't want a static garden to replace the one she already had.
There was dry St. Augustine in the front that hadn't really been well cared for. The back had, there was a deck that went out pretty far into the yard, about halfway, and then there was also St. Augustine.
We wanted to make sure that she had some color and some different textures, and even in the wintertime where we have tawny grasses next to evergreen yuccas, we've been able to have some interest.
Sue wanted her garden to change with a calendar. So even in front, they took out the grass.
My deal was, you know, you fertilized it and you watered it and you mowed it, and then there it was in your front yard and you never saw it, probably. You know, and you were doing it for the people driving down the street who probably never saw it.
One of the first things we did was kind of a border of Pearl d'Or roses along the street. And we had some existing dwarf Yaupon hollies that we kept that were along the driveway and also along the front porch. So that was kind of the bones of the garden. And then we laid out some pathways and just kind of started filling in, you know, layer by layer, having some of the taller things in the middle. And as we got closer to the pathways, the plant material became lower or ground covery.
In a central bed, Patrick built a berm for subtle dimension against the flat walkway that circles it. The garden wasn't a weekend project based on a hardcore roadmap. Instead, it's been an evolution, often prompted by the plants themselves.
Sometimes things don't grow, they don't make it. They need to be moved because of the light or whatever. And I think you just have to, you know, you have to approach it like that. And I think he helped me see that, because I used to think, okay, here's where this is gonna live, you know. Well, it might not like it there.
In back, dynamics changed when Sue lost a central tree, forcing them to revise the initial woodland theme. Although sunshine engaged new ideas, most of the plants adapted within a season and actually preferred the filtered light that now comes their way. The tree's circular bed naturally encouraged a path to follow its lines. Sue traded the overwhelming deck for a stone patio that unites the house with the garden. From its post, Sue can watch the wildlife that stops by, attracted to the garden's incentives, along with the extras she throws in. Patrick's evergreen structure keeps the garden strong, even when winter freezes back some of the perennials.
You get it cut down and you actually see the dirt in your stepping stones, and you see more birds in the winter, and that's fun. This kind of garden in a lot of ways takes care of itself, but you've got to keep it trimmed back. Once you get it established, it's easy to take care of. I mean, people go, oh, you must spend hours out there. And you don't, really. I mean, you could. You know, I might walk out and spend 15 or 20 minutes doing something, and then later in the day you go do something else. There's as much here to do as I want to do, but if I skip a few days, it's okay. And I think if you start small, I wouldn't start a whole yard if you had any reservations. But I think, you know, a lot of people will drive by and stop and they'll say, oh, I wish I could do that. And I'm like, you can. You know, it's not hard. It's sort of fun. You know, you're like, oh, they're enjoying my garden. So, yeah, I mean, it's neat. It's a neat feeling.
Thanks so much, Sue, for opening your garden gate. And coming up next, we're going to be learning about Reed's Nursery in Maxwell, Texas, and a whole lot of cool plants new to Central Texas Gardener. I'm joined by Bill and Christine Reed, and welcome to the show. It's great
to
have you here.
Thank you.
Maxwell, a small town east of San Marcos, and you've both got the nursery bug and the plant bug, mm-hmm. I can tell. But tell me how you got into the business, Bill.
Well, we've always had a passion for gardening, and when the kids got to the age where we didn't have to care for them so much anymore, we decided to strike out. Chris is a master gardener and down in Hays County, and this is a dream of our lifetime.
That's great. You know, so many of the mom-and-pop nurseries are genuinely that. They're the passions of individuals out there who are gardeners.
Absolutely.
And that's why I always encourage people to go and visit those nurseries, because you'll be talking to people who've been there and done that.
Yeah, we love it. We love it.
That's great. Well, let's dive in and talk about the array of plants that you brought, which I'm assuming would be typical for the kinds of things that you offer in the shop.
We try to get the different things that you don't see in the big box stores and things that we love,
right.
That we really appreciate. We try to, again, try to get things that are different, and mm-hmm. we try to get things that are more low water, because
right.
most of us are worried about that.
Oh, yeah, we
and,
should be.
And a lot of things, the things that can take the heat, mm-hmm. you know.
And I also hear that you have an organic emphasis as well. Is that right?
Yeah.
We compost everything that we don't sell. We have a rainwater collection system.
Awesome.
We're very aware of our footprint on the earth, and we're trying to share that with our customers.
That's wonderful. Well, let's, again, dive in and talk about the plants. One we have here is a plant that I absolutely love, and I've never seen it on the show, I don't think.
That's
this is Jerusalem thorn.
Yes.
Tell me a little bit about it.
Well, also called Retama and Palo Verde. It's a great Mexican native. It's wonderful. It handles the heat. Very low water use once it's established. Has those beautiful flowers, orange mm-hmm. and yellow. Very unusual branching. It's really more of an understory tree, though. In other words, it's not a real tall tree,
right.
15 to 20 feet at the most.
I would say full sun.
That's oh,
where
absolutely.
It's happiest.
It can take it, yeah.
It doesn't matter how dry the conditions are. You see it often in disturbed sites.
Right.
And so you know it's growing.
It does really well in this heat, and it's very different, very different.
I love the yellow flowers on this. Really bright show, a fairly long-lasting show for a spring-blooming tree as well.
Yeah, I would say summer to fall or spring to summer. Mm-hmm. In other words, it can be quite a stretch and mm-hmm. very striking, really pretty. And
terrific plant, and one, again, that people should be on the lookout for, a smallish tree. And if you're looking for something that will survive out there at the corner without having to be on the water line, that's it.
Yeah, absolutely. It's nice to have a tree that can handle the low water.
Well, let's keep moving. The next plant we want to talk about is snapdragon vine. And this is one, again, I've never gardened with. Oh. I love the flower form on it. I can understand why they call it snapdragon vine. Tell me a little bit more about this one, Christine.
It's also known as roving sailor. Probably has a few other names.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, it will travel. It's a vine. It loves mm-hmm. to grow. You can hang it like on your porch outside in a hanging basket. It's really pretty.
Mm-hmm.
And it doesn't mind getting a haircut. It does really well if you trim it. It seems to, you know, just makes it grow more. It will reseed, but it's not invasive. It's not a pest.
Yeah, Bill, I understand some of this is growing on your roadside down there.
We actually have it in the greenhouse growing out of pure road base, and it's extremely happy.
Yeah.
Very hardy.
So it'll take the water, but it can handle, you know, drought conditions too, so that's kind of nice.
Well, great hanging basket
really,
plant.
Really sweet.
Okay.
Yeah.
It sounds terrific. And I'm assuming it, you said it recedes, so it goes down in the wintertime.
Well, I think it depends on the environment. Mm-hmm. If it was in a sheltered spot, it might be all right. It depends on the winter, of course.
Sure, yeah.
But regardless, it'll throw off seed. Mm-hmm. And it takes, the cuttings are pretty fast, too. So it propagates pretty easily. So.
Good.
But it's a nice one.
Well, since you've come into the studio here, I've been smelling the yeah. plant next to me, and it is making me very hungry for almond pastry.
Exactly. That's exactly it.
This is called Almond Verbena, and the fragrance is nothing short of intense.
And that is a small flower. I mean,
yeah, this is just a single bloom, really.
It can get quite about 10 feet by 10 feet, mm-hmm. and it's really wonderful when it gets that big.
Yeah, so in a garden setting, I can imagine on a nice day.
It wafts through the air. It's so wonderful. And the butterflies love it. And the deer don't like it, mm-hmm. which is a big plus. Mm-hmm. And another plant that really can handle less water, which is nice, and it can handle our heat. So it's a plus, you know.
More could you ask for.
Yeah.
And when you see a flower shaped like this, it almost always means butterfly attractor.
Absolutely, yeah.
And
that is fun to watch that. They just go all over it, and mm-hmm. different kinds, too, you know, many different kinds.
So you say it forms a large shrub.
Yes.
And then, and I'm assuming it's perennial, goes back to
yes.
the ground.
Yes. Now, it will, being small, it might die back, but it'll mm-hmm. come back. But, of course, the bigger and more established it is, it's deciduous, but it's going to come right back. It does great.
Okay.
It can handle the weather here.
Well, I think you're going to have a flood of people interested
it's a lovely
almond
one.
Verbena.
Yes.
It's a great plant.
It is.
Right next to it, we have a plant that looks a lot like Johnson grass at
first. I know.
But this is called Job's Tears.
Mm-hmm. And it has a few other names, too.
Okay. Well, they all do have common names.
Yes.
But now tell me why Job's Tears.
It's supposed to, I guess, relate back to Job in the Bible and his woe, you know, the mm-hmm. sad stories he dealt with. And the little seeds that form on the plant look like little teardrops.
Okay.
So those are representative of his tears.
I'm going to hold some of these out so people
it's
can see them.
It's been used in other countries for many years to make rosaries and, mm-hmm. and bracelets. It can also be used as a food source. You can mm-hmm. grind them up and make a high-protein mm-hmm. flour. So it's
a true grass with a
absolutely.
Large ornamental seed.
Right. Mm-hmm. It's really fun. But what's really cute mm-hmm. is the seed pod, the bead, has a perfect hole inside. You do not have to make a hole or drill a hole. It will have it has a perfect hole already made. Nature gave it to you.
Okay,
it's
so you can
bead.
Sew through it
yeah.
and create a string just
absolutely.
Like we have here.
Yeah, so it's really fun.
That is cool. Now, we've talked about Malabar spinach before on the program, but frankly, I have forgotten all about this plant, and I just think it's the most striking looking thing.
It's beautiful.
Tell me a little bit more about this plant. I'm assuming it's Malabar spinach. It sounds edible.
Yes,
it is.
It isn't really a spinach, but mm-hmm. it is definitely a edible. It's quite high in nutrients. Mm-hmm. Usually people like to use the more tender, newer leaves.
Right.
You can put it in stir fry. You can put it in your salad. Mm-hmm. And besides that, it's a beautiful vine, and it'll grow. It's not frost hardy, but that's okay because... It produces plenty of seed, and mm-hmm. it may give you some more the next season. So if it does bother you, if it pops up in other places and you're not happy about it, you can always chop it down.
Okay. Well, I'm going to skip around a little bit here because we're running out of time, and we have a couple plants here that we've never talked about. So I want to get to these. Right next to Bill, there is what looks, I've heard it called black-eyed Susan vine, mm-hmm. Is one common name for it. It's mm-hmm. a Thunbergias botanical name. Love the color on this one. Tell me a little bit about the cultivation of this plant.
Well, it's also a great hanging basket mm-hmm. item. To us, it's done beautifully now, but then it'll go kind of dormant in the summer heat. Mm-hmm. But boy, in the fall, it will just push out beautiful cascades of blooms.
Mm-hmm.
It's just stunning and just beautiful long blooms. Very nice plant.
Okay. Well, it looks like a great hanging basket candidate.
Absolutely.
You could put it in a big container at the base of larger plants, let
yes.
it cascade down the side.
You can also put it on the fence and have it climb the fence.
Oh, really?
And sometimes it'll make it through the winter. If mm-hmm. not, you know, it may die back and come back, but it just really depends on the environment. But
that's terrific.
It's a
so
great
it's
fence.
Actually a twining vine as
yes.
well. Perfect.
Yes, it does great on the fence.
Awesome. Well, it sounds like a real winner there. Now, right behind it there, or close to it, we have a plant that I know nothing about. This is anise hyssop. Mm-hmm. Now, anise makes me think that if I go over there and take one of those leaves, I'm going to smell licorice.
Absolutely.
Okay. Tell me a little bit more about this hyssop. This is, again, a new plant
for
us.
That's nice.
Here.
I didn't know. I loved it because it's a great pollinator plant. Mm-hmm. When the flowers form, the pollinators love it. It's a great herb. You can take the leaves and make great teas out of it. Mm-hmm. Being an herb, the deer don't like it,
right?
Which is very nice.
Blooms, I take it.
Yes, beautiful purple blooms. Mm-hmm. And ours in the front area of the nursery in the garden, it went through the summer. It went through that cold snap. Just kept going. It was mulched, but
right.
it handled it. It was really, really tough.
Well,
so it's a great perennial.
Looks like a salvia when I first saw it. I assumed
know,
it was a form of salvia.
But it smells much better.
It's I love the smell of licorice. So one of my favorite is a Mexican marigold mint. So
right, it's very similar.
We have that as well.
Yeah. That's a very nice fragrance.
Okay, so anise hyssop. I love that. Okay,
yeah,
and
fun.
Right behind it, Mexican flame vine. One of the coolest colors, I think, of
Isn't
any flower
great?
Out there. I love the glow on this.
Mm-hmm. It's a beautiful, beautiful summer vining mm-hmm. plant with those gorgeous colors and takes the heat.
Butterfly plant.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It smells like honey to me. The uh-huh. fragrance is wonderful.
Well, and this is one that does well, you know, in hot shaded or a hot patio. Mm-hmm. I've used them in containers before. How about planting these in the ground? What kind of situation do they like?
Well, it's going to die back, mm-hmm. but it'll come back, usually. Mm-hmm. Again, it depends on the winter.
Sure.
This last winter was very challenging for
right.
a lot of things. But it really does like to be trimmed. It's not an aggressive vine, mm-hmm. you know, so that's nice. It's
yeah.
a very nice one. It's very compact.
Okay. Well, Mexican flame vine is the name of that. And real quickly, the nursery is Reed's Nursery in Maxwell, Texas. Real brief description of how you get there.
Well, the quickest way would be to take 150 off of I-35, go north on 21. There's a Bon Ton meat market out there on 21. Take a right-hand turn down 2 miles. And there we are.
All right. Well, thank you so much for coming on Central Texas Gardener. We'll have to have you back.
Thank
Good
you.
Luck to you down there in Maxwell, Texas at
thank
Reed's
you.
Nursery.
Thank you.
Okay, coming up next, it's Daphne with Down to Earth.
Hello and welcome to Down to Earth. Our question this week is on leaves that are turning yellow and what fertilizer to use from them. First of all, you need to ask yourself a series of questions because fertilizer actually might not be the culprit here on yellow leaves. But let's investigate lack of fertilizer first, a lack of nutrients. If the yellowing is on older, lower leaves or newer, upper leaves, you need to decide that first. And overall yellowing or yellowing with green veins, it's another good question to ask yourself. There are two very common nutrient deficiencies in our area, and they are a lack of nitrogen and a lack of iron. It is very rare that other nutrients will be deficient in our soil. A nitrogen deficiency will show symptoms of overall yellowing of the older leaves, and that's because nitrogen is what we call a mobile nutrient. The plant can take nitrogen from its older leaves and send that element to its younger leaves to try to protect itself and keep growing in times of stress. But iron shows up as yellow leaves with green veins on your newer leaves, not on the older leaves. And that's because iron is an immobile nutrient. The plant can't take it from its older leaves and move it to its younger, newer tissue. So most fertilizers do contain nitrogen, but they don't all contain iron. So be sure to read your label closely and look at your plant before you decide what to fertilize with. There are three numbers on the front of fertilizers, and they are nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium in that order. Micronutrients such as iron may be found on the back of the label. If your plants are deficient, give them a quick fertilizer boost, such as from a liquid fertilizer. Then go back and compost if you want to provide a lower amount, slower release fertilizer for this season. But don't assume your plant needs fertilizer. Look closely at it. It may not be related to fertilizer at all. It could be many other problems. Too much or too little water, too cold or too hot weather. Our plant this week is Superbena Purple Verbena. It's a great new verbena cultivar. It has really dark green fuzzy foliage, and it has an intensely dark purple flower, a very nice contrast in our gardens. It's extremely drought and heat tolerant, and it does love full sun. It flowers all summer long with those beautiful purple flowers. They're very long-lasting flowers, and they do fall naturally from the plant without looking messy, so this plant does not require deadheading. Do allow room for the plant to spread. It gets up to 4 feet wide. It stays very short, though, so it's considered a ground cover. It only gets 6 to 12 inches tall, staying a little more on the short side of that. It does attract butterflies, and it takes off as soon as you put it in the ground and starts to really spread quickly. It doesn't need much fertilizer, but a light application of something slow release or compost is great. It's hardy to 15 degrees, so in hard winters it may be an annual. It also looks great trailing over a wall or a bed or a container. To do in your garden this month, you want to check for aphids. They begin to be more active in the last few weeks with the warming weather. And also check for black spot on your roses and spray those that are prone every 7 to 10 days. But look for black spot because you don't want to spray any of your plants unless you notice a problem. We'd love to hear from you. Visit klru.org/ctg to send us your question or plant of the week from your garden.
Thanks, Daphne. Now let's check in with Tricia Shirey for Backyard Basics.
Ladybugs are one of my favorite insects, and their life cycle is very interesting to watch in your garden. Now, you don't have to buy ladybugs. If you have your garden maintained organically and you're not using a lot of pesticides, you should have plenty of ladybugs in your garden. But it is important to have some aphids, their favorite food source. Ladybug will mate and lay their eggs on the underside of leaves where there's a good food supply for the larva. So leave a few plants in your garden, maybe some lettuce, some bok choy, some greens that are stressed from the spring heat, and those plants will become your host plants for ladybugs. Now the eggs are laid in clusters on the underside of leaves, so you want to check and examine leaves before you take them into the kitchen. Often I found them on the underside of mint leaves or lettuce leaves as I'm harvesting things to take inside. So if I see those yellow jelly bean-like eggs on the underside of the leaves, I make sure and leave those in the garden. They lay their eggs on the underside of the leaves to protect the eggs from predators. Sometimes the eggs will not be fertile. Some of the eggs will not be fertile, and that allows the newly hatched ladybug larva to eat the unfertilized eggs and have an instant food source. But they'll start crawling all over the plants and devouring insects. Again, aphids are their favorite, but they'll also eat mites and mealybugs and scale and many other insects in the garden. And the larvae are very hungry and eating constantly. So they have to shed their skin several times during the larval stage. And the larvae look like little crocodiles. They're black and orange. They start out small, and then they'll split and shed their skin, and so you'll see little black skins on the underside of leaves, and then they'll finally become a pupa, so that larva will attach itself to the underside of a leaf again and will pupate and stay in the pupal stage for several more days and then hatch out as an adult lady beetle. And the adults will be a lighter color when they first hatch, and the shell will harden. They're very susceptible to predators at that time, so they usually stay hidden. But the shell hardens and darkens, and then they develop the spots, and they become the adult lady beetles that we all know. It's a good idea also to leave some plants in your garden to bloom, because the adult ladybugs like nectar flowers. So I like to leave some parsley, some cilantro, dill. All of the members of the Umbellifera family are great nectar sources for the ladybugs. And give them a little bit of a sprinkle in the mornings if the weather is dry, because they appreciate some moisture on the foliage of your plants. But you don't have to purchase ladybugs. If you have the right sources in your garden for the adults to have the nectar and a good food source of aphids for the larva, there is a weed that grows quite commonly in the spring called the sow thistle, and it's usually filled with aphids. And so I sometimes leave a few of those in the garden. You can pull the flowers off if you're worried about it going to seed, but that becomes a great food source for ladybugs. So as long as you have the right ingredients in your garden, you'll have lots of these wonderful creatures, and they're just really fun to watch in the garden.
Visit klru.org/ctg for online video, today's tips, and our weekly blog. Next week, we take you to new heights with green roofs. Until then, I'll see you in the garden.
To learn about today's program, watch online, and follow CTG's blog, check out klru.org/ctg.